Okay.
Yeah,
I'm glad everybody's here. Everybody having a good summer? It's really summer officially today, right?
Yep.
Yeah, or was it yesterday? Today. Welcome to summer. I like it. I don't like it because my air conditioning doesn't work in my car, so that sucks. But I do like being warm. We are going to continue working through the New Testament tonight, but we're going to start with an Old Testament passage to get us there, because if you, maybe you guys don't even know what those words mean. Old Testament is before Jesus came. There was 66, no, not 66, that's the whole Bible. There was, oh shoot, this Bible trivia, that's just bad. 40, how many books in the Old Testament? 49, good job. 39, because there's 27 in the New, that makes sense. 39 books written before Jesus was born, and all of them in some way, shape, or form point to the coming of Jesus. That's the Old Testament. The New Testament is all the books, the 27 books written since Jesus came. Four of them are biographies of Jesus' life. One of them is a history book of the early church, and then there's a whole bunch of letters after that. The history book is what we're in. It's called Acts of the Apostles. It really should be called Acts of Jesus. Because the way that Luke introduces it, he's saying, here's the stuff that Jesus continued to do through the church. So, a really cool book. So we are in the second chapter of the book of Acts, where a whole new era in world history begins. It's an amazing chapter, and I'm excited to dig into it. But all of the New Testament authors relied on the scriptures that came before Jesus. They quote it all the time. They had this stuff memorized. The Old Testament, they had it memorized. They knew it by heart. They passed it down to their children. All their festivities, they would be quoting the Old Testament. They'd sing the book of Psalms as their songs together as families and during their festivals. They knew this Old Testament really well. And so all the New Testament writers use the Old Testament a lot in what they're saying. And so if we don't have any understanding of the Old Testament, we have a hard time understanding the New Testament, because it all goes together. It's all God's inspired word, and it's inerrant as originally given, so the original manuscripts have no errors in them. And we actually have so many manuscripts, we're really pretty close to, very, very close to having the original, but we don't quite have the original manuscripts. But this, regardless, this is God's word given to us to reveal the heart of God to us. Jesus makes it clear in who he is and helps reveal to us what the word means. So we're going to take a look at the Old Testament first, like I said, in the book of Joel. So if you want to find the book of Joel in your Bible, either on your Bible app or in a physical Bible if you've got one. If you've got a physical Bible exactly the same as mine, it's on page 1085, but nobody in the room does, so that doesn't help you at all. But it's actually pretty close to the New Testament. It's one of the last, one of the minor prophets, which are all at the back of the Old Testament. We're going to be in Joel chapters 1 and 2. Before we do, I want you to try to imagine yourself in the scene. So we'll do a little imaginative journey 2,500 years ago. Maybe 2,600 years ago, about 500 or 600 years before Jesus came on the scene. We are in the nation of Israel right now, so we're in the Middle East. And so picture yourself, you're between 18 and 30, and you live somewhere in the Middle East 2,500 years ago. Your house is probably kind of like this small house with a porch on top where you could go outside and rest up top. The inside, if you're not very wealthy, the first level probably has some animals in there with feeding troughs, some beds for the whole family and extended family. And so several people all live in this one big room on the bottom floor. The houses probably all kind of make a courtyard. They kind of are all centered around a courtyard in the middle, where the women go and prepare food and grind wheat and the kinds of things that women back then were expected to do for the families. And that's where they would talk and catch up and figure things out for their families. while men were out doing agriculture, and they were planting crops, or they were shepherding sheep, or they were but very dependent on the land, either to eat the food that they grew or raised, or trade that the stuff that they grew or raised, or the traded their manual labor, like Jesus the carpenter, for things that other people raised or grew, but very dependent on the land. Are you kind of picturing it?
Yeah.
All right, now it's probably hot. We're in summer. It's hot. You're near one of these plants that you depend on, okay? Whether you're male or female, you're near one of the trees or the bushes that produce crops for all of us, and we all depend on these. And you see flying and laying on it a little grasshopper. And at first you're like, whatever, a little grasshopper. Then you look closer and you're like, oh no, it's a locust. And then you see another one. And then you see another one. And then you see 1,000 other ones. They're all coming and they're landing on these plants. And these locusts can eat their body weight in food every day. And so they're munching and munching and munching on what you need to survive. And then after 1,000 of them come, 1,000,000,000 of them come. You look out into the distance and there's a cloud. And this cloud could be 10 miles wide and 10 miles deep. Each square mile containing billions, I think it's 10 to 40 billion locusts. Can't even wrap my mind around that. But they're on their way. There's a cloud of locusts coming into your village. And you depend on the crops of the ground to survive. Let's take a look at BBC Planet or something like that to see what this could, because these still exist today. And in 2020, there was a big problem with locusts in Africa. This does have sound. You got the sound?
They look like birds.
Yeah, they look like birds right now.
Can you eat them? Get
that's a good question. I don't know if you need them.
There is no other species on the planet that responds as quickly and as dramatically to the good times as the desert locust. Eggs that have remained in the ground for 20 years begin to hatch. The young locusts are known as hoppers, for at this stage they're flightless. They find new feeding grounds by following the smell of sprouting grass. Normally, it takes 4 weeks for hoppers to become adults, but when the conditions are right, as now, their development switches to the fast track. As the vegetation in one place begins to run out, the winged adults release pheromones, scent messages, which tell others in the group that they must move on. And when groups merge, they form a swarm. Hundreds of tons of vegetation. They have to keep on moving. The swarm travels with the wind. It's the most energy-saving way of flying. Following the flow of wind means that they're always heading toward areas of low pressure, places where wind meets rain and vegetation starts to grow. As they fly, swarms join up with other swarms to form gigantic plagues several billion strong and as much as 40 miles wide. They will consume every edible thing that lies in their path. This is one of planet Earth's greatest spectacles. It's rarely seen on this scale, and it won't last long. Once the food has gone, the steady roar of a billion beating locust wings will once again be replaced by nothing more than the sound of the desert wind.
All right, scary stuff, right? Imagine watching that coming towards you and all that you care about and all your livelihood. Well, the book of Joel was written in the midst of one of those, the midst of one of these plagues of locusts. So let's hear what Joel says. He's one of the prophets. Oh, this is another thing that I wanted you to imagine as you imagine yourself in Israel 2,500 years ago. Your religion is Judaism. You believe in one God. You believe that that God is good and faithful, and that that God redeemed Israel out of Egypt at one point and made Israel his nation and is faithful to his covenant. But you believe that that God lives over in Jerusalem in the temple. You know he's everywhere, but he lives in a special way in Jerusalem, in the temple, and only the priests really get access to him. And every once in a while, a random person gets access to the Holy Spirit, where the Holy Spirit comes upon a random person, seemingly, and makes them a prophet. And suddenly they can speak for God, or suddenly they can do miracles. Sometimes there were groups of prophets in the Old Testament, and they would have ecstatic experiences and prophesy and say what was on God's heart. Others were individuals. You think of Elijah and Elisha, kind of roaming and making miraculous things happen, even raising the dead, the Holy Spirit coming upon individuals. And so you hear stories of these individuals, but nobody would ever really expect it to be them because it was so rare and few and far between. Every once in a while, the Holy Spirit would come upon an individual person. Well, now imagine in your town, this is happening, chaos is ensuing, and somebody stands up in your village named Joel, and he's filled with the Spirit, or the Spirit comes upon him is the better way to say it from the Old Testament. And the Spirit comes upon him and he says, "This is the Lord's message that came to Joel, the son of Pethuel. Listen to this, you elders. Pay attention, all inhabitants of the land. Has anything like this ever happened in your whole life? Or in the lifetime of your ancestors? Tell your children about it. Have your children tell their children, and their children the following generation." And then he lists four species or life stages of locusts. We don't know what the Hebrew words necessarily mean. He says, "What the Gozim locust left, the Arbe locust consumed. What the Arbe locust left, the Yalek locust consumed. And what the Yalek locust left, the Hasa locust consumed." All the locusts are here and whatever, and there's nothing left. Everything is being eaten. In verse 6 and 7, he says, "Their teeth are lion's teeth. They have the fangs of a lioness. They have destroyed my vines. They have turned my fig trees into mere splinters." All of our precious crops are gone, just totally devastated. And so God, what we have here is we have God, the Spirit of God, inspiring a prophet to feel the pain of the people, to name the pain of the people. God is naming it. God is saying, look at what's happening. Look how devastating this is. And the first part of really grieving something that's painful is to name it, to talk about it in clear terms. Talk about in helpful terms. And this is what the prophet is doing. God is showing that he understands what's going on here. He goes, they continue to talk about the specific details of what's happening. And then the prophet Joel wants them to know that this also has spiritual implications for them, because in the temple, what would they offer as sacrifices in the temple to make sure that they were good with God? It was either animals or crops or wine. All stuff that is going to be deeply impacted by this devastation of the locusts. And so Joel is calling to their attention, this is bad for us spiritually too, because how are we going to make sacrifices to God when there's nothing left? So in verse 9 he says, "No one brings grain offerings or drink offerings to the temple of the Lord anymore. So the priests, those who serve the Lord, are in mourning. The crops of the fields have been destroyed." So their link to God seems like it's gone, right? The locusts have taken everything, including their ability to make sacrifices to God, the only way that they know how to make peace with God in the Old Testament. This is bad. This is really bad. And the prophet is naming how much this hurts and how painful this is. So then here's his solution. He says, announce a holy fast. Proclaim a sacred assembly. Gather the elders and all the inhabitants of the land to the temple of the Lord your God, and cry out to the Lord. Sorry, that was verse 14. Announce a holy fast, proclaim a sacred assembly, and cry out to the Lord. So here we have God naming what's happening, naming how painful it is, reminding them that this actually could have spiritual ramifications, and then asking them to take God seriously. Take God seriously in this moment. Cry out to God in this moment. Ask God for help in this moment where you need him desperately. Interesting, right? I'll pause there just to kind of make an application to our lives. This is relatable, isn't it? Sometimes we feel like the locusts are attacking. Like we could control two or three locusts, maybe 30. I bet I could take out, I get a BB gun and take out a whole bunch of those things. But 10 billion, not a chance, right? There's a point where they can overwhelm and there's you just give up. Like, there would be nothing anyone could do to stop that, right? And sometimes life feels like that. There is nothing I could possibly do to stop the swarm of pain, the swarm of anxiety, the swarm of depression, the swarm of bad things just piling up, the swarm of unfortunate circumstances in my life. I just feel hopeless, right? Does that ever feel that way? Like, I just feel like the army against me, marching against me, is too strong. And I think if you're able to name that, you can actually connect with God, who also is willing to name that. You see the prophet willing to name the pain, willing to name how serious this is. He's like, that's amazing. We usually jump to like, God, why didn't you stop it then, right? But let's follow the process of scripture here. God is willing to name the pain and to talk about how hard it is. And then he actually, notice, God gave Joel these words, and they're poetic. If you read this book, it's only 3 chapters, take you 20 minutes. If you read this book, you're going to see how like articulate and poetic and descriptive the words are for this painful event. Beautiful. Like a master poet would be trying to put these kind of words like to describe their feelings, and God does that here for them to help them process what they're feeling. I love it. It's so it just shows how much God sees their pain, understands their pain, and even helps them articulate it so that they can process it. And then in the midst of that, in the midst of saying, yes, it's real, it hurts, God asks them to take him seriously, right? He says, now proclaim a holy fast, gather the elders, gather together all the inhabitants of the land to the temple, and cry out to the Lord. Get together with your friends. Get together with the people you trust. Join community and be part of community like you are here. And together, cry out to the Lord for help. I think we're gathering the assembly together and crying out for help when we put a prayer request in the Discord, right? Seems like, no, I think that's real. I think that like we're obeying scripture here. When we gather together and we go in the prayer request channel and we say, hey, I need some help. Will you guys cry out to God for me or with me because I'm struggling? And we do that. We cry out to the Lord together. That's so good. That's what the Lord is saying. When you're in this moment, take God seriously and cry out to him for help. It's beautiful. So first application point for the night. When life feels like the locusts are just coming and not stopping and they're about to eat up everything, allow the Spirit to help you feel that. Like, you don't have to figure out and then come to God. That doesn't work. God wants you to invite him into that process and start telling him how the pain feels. And he might actually even give you more words to tell you even with more clarity how the pain feels. And then in the process, take him seriously and say, Lord, if there's anything that I need to do to align with you better right now, if I need to say no to things I've been doing, or turn from sin I've been committing, or forgive people I've been harboring anger against, It can be a good time to search your soul a little bit. Now, it can also be bad to take that further and blame yourself for all the bad things that are going on. Say, I must have done something terrible for life to be terrible. The whole Bible teaches us that logic is not true. If you read the book of Job, that logic is not true. That because it's not always necessarily true that if bad things are happening in your life, it's because you did something bad. The Bible doesn't teach that. But the Bible does teach sometimes that if we are committing sin or we're out of alignment with God's will, well, always if we're out of alignment with God's will, things will not be going as well as they could, because God's will is good and perfect and pleasing. So when we align with God's will, things will get better in our lives. So take the Lord seriously and then cry out to him for help. He's there. He's ready to help. Then I'm going to move, I kind of covered two verses. Let's move up to Joel chapter 2, verse 19. And I think I might have that on the screen. I'm not sure. It says, "Then the Lord became zealous for his land." So it seems like the people did it. They gathered, they cried up to the Lord, they took God seriously. They searched their souls, they repented where they needed to, they turned back to God, and God responds. He answers. It's funny that he's responding because he also initiated the conversation, right? He also gave Joel all these beautiful words to express the pain and said, cry out to me and ask for help. And then after they ask for help, he responds. It's beautiful. God is in the whole process. And here's how he responds. Hear this, especially if you're feeling like you're in a place where the locusts are eating up your life. He says, "Look, I am about to restore your grain, as well as fresh wine and olive oil. You will be fully satisfied. I will never again make you an object of mockery among the nations." There's beautiful promises that continue like that. Let's jump down to verse 25. "I will make up for the years that the Arabah locusts consumed, or that the Arabe, or however you say it, locust, consumed your crops. That the Yalek locust, the Hasa locust, and the Gazam locust, my great army that I sent against you, you will have plenty to eat, and your hunger will be fully satisfied. Everything that has been taken from you, I will restore. Everything that's been stolen, I will give to you." God is saying there is hope, there is promise. If you're in pain, if you're confusion, if your life feels like the locusts are just eating it up, you will have, there is hope in the Lord. He will bring restoration to your life. He will bring you the good things that the enemy stole away from you. It's beautiful. It's promise from Scripture. Now, that can be complicated. We can't get into all the nuances of that. Like, well, what if I lost a loved one? How is God going to give me that back? Well, in one sense, we get to reunite with believers in heaven, right? But also in another sense, Jesus said, like, when you join the community of Christians, when you join the community of the church, you gain brothers and sisters and mothers and fathers and the deepest type of community. And so those who suffer loss, Jesus is personally concerned with restoring relationship. If you lost relationship, he's going to restore relationship in your life. If you lost connection with people, he's going to restore connection with people in your life. Now, obviously, maybe not always the same people, but he's going to restore if you've lost. So hold on to hope. There is hope. There's so much hope. Jesus, God is so good. I love, just think about that process and the goodness of God in it. He initiated to express the pain and what the pain feels like. He initiated for you to cry out to him, and then he promises to restore everything. And then here it gets even more beautiful in this book. He said, "I'm going to give you back everything that was taken. And while I'm at it," check this out, while we're at it talking about the blessings of God, think about this. And then in Joel 2:28, he says, "After all of this, after I restore everything, after I make it so you're never a mockery again, after I make it so all the things that the enemy has stolen, after all of this, I will pour out my spirit on all kinds of people." Your sons and your daughters will prophesy. Your elderly will have prophetic dreams. Your young men will see visions. Even on male and female servants, I will pour out my spirit in those days. I will produce portents both in sky and on the earth, blood, fire, and columns of smoke. The sunlight will be turned to darkness and the moon to the color of blood before the great day of the Lord comes, that great and terrible day. It will so happen that everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. So some interpretation required here, but what he's saying is on top of restoring everything that you've lost, there's going to be a day where I'm going to personally pour out my spirit on all kinds of people. Remember how God would selectively choose just a couple, and Joel got to be one of the lucky ones, right, throughout scripture that the Spirit poured out on top of? Now he's saying there's going to be a day where all kinds of people are going to be able to receive the Spirit. Men and women, boys and girls, and no matter your socioeconomic status, it says in Joel. Joel maybe didn't even have the imagination, or maybe he couldn't hear what God was, no, he heard what God was saying. I don't think he was ready to have the full revelation yet, because very soon in scripture it also adds, no matter what ethnicity you come from, no matter what cultural background you come from as well, Joel kind of stays, maybe the people that Joel had to speak to, this is the message they had to hear. Scripture is right and no errors, but it's beautiful to interpret this scripture with Galatians 3:28, which adds, there's no Jew nor Gentile, and to the list of why there's no distinctions among who is going to be able to receive the Holy Spirit. So, he says, all people are going to have access to the Holy Spirit one day. It's beautiful. So imagine sitting there, maybe the locusts have just cleared, all your stuff is gone, but the prophet of the Lord has said, don't worry, all of it will be restored, you're going to be okay, you're not going to die from hunger, even though it looks like you're going to, and someday, all of you are going to have access to the Holy Spirit. Imagine that kind of waiting. I kind of hate that kind of waiting. I mean, it's beautiful. It's awesome to have a promise of something really good in the future. But it also sucks because you're like, it's not now, right? Like, I want it now, but it's coming later. It's hard to wait. I remember as a kid when my parents would say, we're going to Disney World this summer. They said that one Christmas, we opened up these like letters and we had to puzzle them all together and it said Disney World and it was super fun. But then it was like, it dawned on us like, well, it's December and that's June. So that's a fun present, except it's not fun today, right? It's fun to look forward to it, but we're not in Disney World right now. And so we had to wait 6 months to get our present. And that waiting is kind of painful. Or like the Metro Parks, I think there's some pictures. Have you guys been to East 55th Street Marina? There's like nothing to see there. I think it's the next photo. There's like nothing there. It's kind of a dump. The next picture shows like it's just a parking lot and a place to fish. But the Metro Parks is planning on putting millions and millions and millions of dollars into this area to make it look like that someday. And the shoreline is like at the bottom, so they're going to actually build all of that land and make islands and bays and places to bird watch. And it's going to be beautiful. It's going to be amazing. It's going to be way better than Edgewater Park. It'll be bigger. It'll be a whole, like an island that doesn't exist now will be built up there, and it'll be really cool. They're going to put millions of dollars in it. Cool, right? We're like, let's go have our next young adult event there. Well, maybe your grandkids will be able to, because they don't even have an estimate on when it might possibly be built, and it might be like 35 years from now. So, is that good news or bad news? You tell me, right? Like, it's good news, but it was fun, like, the second you saw, like, people flying the kite, but now that you think about, oh, those are my great-grandkids flying that kite. Okay. Cool for them. Yay for them. that feeling of, like, wow, that's going to be really cool for somebody someday, but what about me now? I want, and if you're that Israelite, I want the Holy Spirit for me now. I want to be like that guy Joel who, like, connected with the heart of God and was able to like cry in front of us and say, look, I know how much it hurts. Cry out to the Lord. There will be restoration. I want that. I want the Holy Spirit to come inside of me, right? Well, don't you want that? Don't you crave that? Well, let me tell you good news. It's not Christmas. It's July and we get to go to Disney World. We are in the era where the Holy Spirit has been poured out. But some of us might be living like we're in the era before the Holy Spirit was poured out. Some of us might be living like we're in the area where we don't have access to God, where God lives over there in Jerusalem, or God lives over there in somebody else's life, or God selects a few pastors maybe, but not me. That is not true. We are in the era where God has poured out His Spirit on all people, men and women, girls and boys, rich and poor, and every ethnicity, every person across the world has access now to the Holy Spirit. Let's look at where that happened. Now we're going to get to our passage for the night, but I promise it won't be long. Acts chapter 2. In Acts chapter 1, remember from last week, Jesus told him, don't leave Jerusalem, right before he ascended into the clouds. He said, don't leave Jerusalem, but wait for the gift my Father promised, which you have heard me speak about, for John baptized with water, but in a few days, they'll be baptized with the Holy Spirit. So for 600 years, people have been waiting for the prophecy of Joel to be completed. That's a lot of generations. That's a lot of people who died between Joel and Jesus, and now Jesus is saying, it's a few days away. That's awesome. That's good news, right? Like when you're 3 days away from going to Disney World, then it's fun again. Then you're starting to pack, and you're starting to get ready, and you're starting to like look up like how to skip the lines or strategy or how to do it the best, right? Then you're getting excited. You're a few days away, and then he says you're gonna receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you'll be my witnesses in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. He's promising that the Holy Spirit's coming. The implications of the Holy Spirit coming is that you're going to have power. And the implications of that power is that you're going to go witness to Jesus all across the earth. And so Jesus is concerned that this good news reaches all kinds of people. Just like Joel was concerned that the Holy Spirit would be poured out on all kinds of people. And then we see it happen. Acts chapter 2. Let's take a look. It says that they obeyed Jesus, right? They were in Jerusalem. They were hanging out together. They're having a significant prayer time together, which if you've ever been like with people who all they want is Jesus, and you're praying fervently together, there's nothing like it in the world. It's the best experience to be with a bunch of people who just desperately want to pray and meet with God and wait for the Holy Spirit to come. This is the kind of prayer meeting they're in. But they've never really experienced what it's like for the Holy Spirit to fill them. So it's also like anxious and anticipatory, like what is going to happen? But he said it's in a few days, and it's been a few days. And so now when the day of Pentecost had come, they were all together in one place. And suddenly a sound like a violent wind blowing came from heaven and filled the entire house where they were sitting. And tongues spreading out like a fire appeared to them and came to rest on each one of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit, and each one of them began to speak in other languages as the Spirit enabled them. Now there were devout Jews from every nation under heaven residing in Jerusalem. When this sound occurred, a crowd gathered and was in confusion because each one heard them speaking in his own language. Completely baffled, they said, aren't all these who are speaking Galileans? And how is it that each one of us hears them in our own native language? Parthians, Medes, Elamites, and residents of Mesopotamia, Judea, and Cappadocia, Pontus, and the province of Asia, Phrygia, and Pamphylia, Egypt, and the parts of Libya and Cyrene, and visitors from Rome, both Jews and proselytes, so not all, even just Jews, Cretans and Arabs. We hear them speaking in our own languages about the great deeds God has done. So the day of waiting is over. The new era has arrived. Where it used to be a few individuals received the Holy Spirit, now the promise from Joel has been fulfilled. Now all kinds of people can receive the Holy Spirit. It's been poured out. This is the birth of the church. There was no church before this day. Now the church is born, and the Holy Spirit is poured out on people. And did you notice the very first miracle that God is concerned with giving them is on the very first minute of the birthday of the church? It's the gift of speaking other languages. It's nuanced from the gift of tongues that we talk about later. It's the gift of speaking other languages so that other kinds of people could immediately hear the good news of Jesus and immediately be part of the church. God didn't waste a minute where it was just Israelites in the church. Now that the church is born, this needs to be for everybody. And so the very first minute that the Holy Spirit is poured out on the church, God makes them change their language so they can't even just speak to each other. They are not even able to just speak to the people who are like them because the people who are like them don't understand what they're talking about. They have to go out and find the people who understands what the heck they're saying because now they're speaking in new language. And so they're having to go find people that don't look like them and don't have cultural practices like them and don't smell like them because they cook with different spices, right? They have to go find those people and proclaim the good news of Jesus to them because it's the only way that the Spirit has poured, that's the gift that the Spirit has given for the birth of the church. Isn't that beautiful? And so the church has to be this diverse and beautiful and multicultural movement of people that represents people from all over the world. It's birthed in to the very first breath of what the church is. I think that's amazing. It's what Joel prophesied, all kinds of people, but like, again, he didn't mention all ethnicities, but so maybe he was even surprised, like, whoa, I didn't even know what I meant. That's amazing, right? And now, Jesus was making it clear it's going to be for Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and the ends of the earth. And now, when it's poured out, the Holy Spirit makes his agenda very clear that I'm going to all people everywhere. And people are so amazed. And they're like, why are we hearing this good news about God spoken in our language? I haven't had the experience very often of being someone in a country where I don't speak the majority language, but I'm sure it's difficult, right? Like, you're navigating life in a second language, you're making it work, but if you're always having to think about the words that you say, that's tough, right? And then when you hear somebody speak your own language, I'm sure it's like, wow, it's so easy, right? I can understand what they're saying so easily from my heart. This is how my mom talked to me, right? This is how my dad would speak to me. This is the like true heart language that I speak. To have somebody else speak the good news in your heart language had to be incredibly moving for all of these people who are in Jerusalem feeling like foreigners, and now God is personally bringing the message straight to them because it's top priority for him that all people everywhere would be able to experience the good news. It's fun. The church is beautiful. The beginning, this is us, our birthday story, right? Happy birthday to the church in Acts chapter 2. And then if you want to know why I made the connection between Joel, it's probably very obvious, but it can become even more obvious if we read the next few verses. Acts chapter 2, starting with verse 16. So then people accuse them of being drunk, which I have that doesn't make any sense to me. I've never seen anybody get smarter by getting drunk, right? Like, learn a new language by getting drunk. That's ridiculous. But they said they must be speaking like this because they're drunk. That was probably the people who only spoke the majority language, and so everything sounded like gibberish to them. So Peter says, no, it's only 9 in the morning, which is interesting. Yeah, sure, like that's an okay reason but also it's just obvious nobody gets drunk and speaks new languages. Anyways, it's only 9 o'clock in the morning, but this is what was spoken about through the prophet Joel. And then he quotes what we just read. In the last days, it will be that God says that I will pour out my spirit on all people, and your sons and daughters will prophesy, and your young men will see visions, and your old men will dream dreams. Even on my servants, both men and women, I will pour out my spirit on those days, and they will prophesy. So I want it to be so clear in all of our hearts that we now have access to the power of the Holy Spirit, no matter who we are. We now have access to the Spirit. What the people longed for, what Joel promised, what the people craved, to be that close with God, where God would actually live inside of me. and the power that comes with the Holy Spirit living inside of us. We emphasize a lot that it's power for character, power for good living, power to bear good fruit in our life, but it's also power to do miracles. It's also power to heal when God calls us to. It's also power to speak in other kinds of languages when God gives us that ability. My wife went to Africa on a missions trip to Gabon, and she was at a hospital for a little while, and then they went to like this little clinic way out in the bush, and her job on the missions trip was to help people as they were getting checked in and figure out what was wrong with them so the doctors could know. My wife doesn't speak any French at all, and she's the one that's connecting with all these people who are speaking in French to her about their ailments, and she worked with them for several hours and checked everybody in and communicated back and forth with them, and at the end of the day realized, like, what was I doing? Like, how did we talk? The Spirit gave her the ability to communicate in French with these people, and a bunch of them got saved, and they got medical treatment that they needed. Isn't that beautiful? I had another friend in Mexico. She was doing a mission trip, and she sat down on the bench next to somebody. She also didn't speak Spanish, and she sat next to this guy and had a 20-minute conversation in Spanish with him, led him to accept Jesus as his Savior, and left and still couldn't speak Spanish after that. But for those 20 minutes, she could. It still happens today. That was one of my best friends in high school and my wife, so I'm surrounded by these people. It's beautiful. God still does this stuff today. The power of the Holy Spirit is accessible to us today. And if we're gonna, the more we step out in uncomfortable situations and put ourselves in places where we desperately depend on the power of the Holy Spirit to do anything effective, the more odds that we would have experiences like that. So stretch yourself. Put yourself in positions where you're not, like, if God is leading you to a position and you're not quite sure if you're capable, don't forget you have the Holy Spirit in you. It's so inspiring. I'll wrap it up by saying that we can expect the Spirit to fill us. Anybody who has accepted Jesus as your Savior can expect the Holy Spirit to fill them. And if you're like, oh man, I kind of missed my chance because I was 10 years old when that happened, or 5 years old, or it was a couple years ago, and so that didn't seem that dramatic, and it's not about a one-time experience. I think it's really cool if you look at Acts chapter 4, same people are praying in another room together. They've just been persecuted now. They've been thrown in prison overnight. And so they're like, God, please help us. And when they had prayed, the place where they were assembled together was shaken. And they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak the word of God courageously. That one's awesome. The evidence of being filled with the Holy Spirit in Acts chapter 4, verse 31, which I just read, is speaking the word of God with boldness. That one never even said any kind of tongues. That was just speaking the word of God with boldness as evidence that they were filled with the Holy Spirit. And it was a second filling, right? Another time they were filled. And I imagine these guys have been filled with the Holy Spirit several times in between. They've been thrown in jail. They probably said, Lord, we need you. Help us. Give us words to say. And they kept having the courage and the power to do what they were asked to do. In between, they had healed a crippled person. Book of Acts is awesome. You guys got to make sure you read through this while we're preaching through it. The power of the Holy Spirit was given to them. And then we read this last week, but I want to remind you, because some people might say, well, that was just for the apostles. Well, the apostle Peter, under the authority of the Holy Spirit, prophetically speaking, told us that it was not just for him. So I don't know how somebody might still think that it's just for the apostles, but he said so clearly in Acts chapter 2, verse 38, that this is for all of us. Here's what it says. He says, repent, and each of you be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. For the promise, and he's referring to the promise that Joel promised, that young men and women would prophesy and dream dreams, the power that they're seeing, the promise is for you and your children, and for all who are far away, as many as the Lord would call to himself. Anyone who's a believer in Jesus has the power of the Holy Spirit available to you. That's you and you and you and you and you and me. Any one of us in this room who have accepted Christ as our Savior, the Holy Spirit is available. So my encouragement to all of us is just be filled with the Holy Spirit. I love how they gather together to pray for that. Gather together. I heard this week of a group that's been gathering consistently together, of some of the people among us, to hold each other accountable and pray for each other. And I think that's so awesome. I think the Spirit is gonna pour out in powerful ways in that group. I'd love to see more of that. I didn't even know about it until they'd been meeting several times. That's awesome. I would love for that to happen more and more, where people are like, I want the Holy Spirit. And the biblical example is that they pray together for the Holy Spirit. You can't pray on your own for the Holy Spirit too. But it happens in power twice in these two chapters when they gather together, cry out to the Lord and ask to be filled with the Spirit. I'd love to see more of that. And I want you guys, with your young faith, to inspire me with my like old man faith now. Because sometimes like my stories are getting kind of old. Like I haven't had any of these like really amazing, like I stepped out in faith moments in a while, and it's concerning me. But in college, I was a little better at it. Maybe it's because my faith was like younger and I was a little bit less like smart about like what's safe or whatever. But I would love to be inspired by your stories. So that's my challenge. Come inspire me in the next few weeks of things that you were able to step out and see the Holy Spirit do through your life. Because I need it. I need to be inspired by you. And I'm speaking on behalf of all the 35-year-olds at Grace Church. everybody else. I want like each of us can inspire and sharpen one another. And so let's do that. Let's seek after the filling of the Holy Spirit. May we never live like we're still waiting. Because that would be dumb to be at Disney World and like still have those same feelings of like, I can't wait till we get to Disney World. Right? We're here. We have arrived in the new era where the Holy Spirit is available. Let's live into it. Let me pray. Jesus, we are so, so grateful that you died on the cross to pay for our sins so that you could proclaim that we are holy now, not by our own righteousness, but by yours. And so we receive your holiness, your cleansing, that you would separate us, make us separate from the world, make us separate to righteousness. And in that moment, also that you would personally come and fill us. That you would personally come and give us your power. That you would give us your character. That you would give us your heart. That you give us your love. So Holy Spirit, come. We prayed this last week, but in the same manner as Acts 4, we pray again together. Holy Spirit, fill us. Fill us fresh. And Lord, would you, I'm going to pray a dangerous prayer, would you send us into some places this week where we desperately need you to show up to do the things that you want to do? Somebody who needs healing and we're prompted to go pray. Or somebody we can't understand and we're prompted to go speak to them anyways. Or whatever you want to do, there's so many ways that you work miracles. But I pray that we would be able to step into places this week where we're stretched out of our comfort zones and we are forced to depend on you and to call out to you, get serious with you, and see you move. I pray for those who are in the middle of that season where the locusts are eating and gnawing away at the good things in our life. And we're confused and we're lost and we're weary. Holy Spirit, as you fill us, now in this deeper, more personal way than Jews back then could have understood, would you speak straight to us the fact that you care? Give us the words to articulate our pain and our confusion. Convict us and help us get to that point where we can take you seriously and cry out to you. And may we hear that promise spoken from you into our ears, because it might be hard to hear from someone else, that you will restore and that you are faithful and you will give back what we have lost. And on top of it, you'll fill us and refill us with your Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name, amen. Cool, that was a little bit of a roller coaster, and I apologize for that. I went like deep into pain and then way up into excitement, and it's all mashed together now for you to have discussion about. So you don't have to go in order with these questions. Feel free to like answer the ones that feel like you want to talk about them, because like I said, like some are in the valley and some are on the mountain, and you might not be in both places at once, and that's okay. A quick little note about sharing at your tables. Had a good conversation with some people this week about just to remind each other, like it's good to share and be vulnerable, but some things maybe are better to be said one-on-one with somebody else than like oversharing in a group like this. So just be mindful of like your own, like not, this is a safe place to share, but also it's a public place, anybody can come. So just like, it's not bad to kind of guard the words that you want to share. The level of vulnerability should always match the level of trust you have with the people around you. So that's okay. And then if you feel like you really need to be vulnerable and you really have something deep you need to share with somebody, if you haven't made a good friend yet to share with here, I'm going to be always available to talk. Or if you're like, hey, can you help me find someone who's my gender to talk with, I can connect you as well. So I just want to make sure that this feels like a really safe place for everybody. Also, if somebody else overshares at your table, sometimes that can make other people feel awkward. And so maybe even if you're like, I'm fine, I'm an open book, I'll talk about my whole sexual history right now, other people might not want to hear about it right now. So just be judicious. I don't have any rules or anything right now. Maybe we'll have guidelines someday. But for now, just, yeah. I'm not saying it because it's been an issue either. I'm just mostly saying it because I'm like, we should probably talk about that every once in a while. So it's because it's a public space where we're sharing pretty deeply. So all that said, I'll be over here to pray for anybody who wants to pray. You guys have at it with conversation. I love you all, and so glad that all of you guys made it.